Hello everyone. Welcome to the fourth video in this series, Paint. We're going to explore the idea of the underpainting. And this particular technique, which can be referred to as also a preparation, we could also put into the idea of the sketch, the drawing, the sketch for the painting. The initial phase, it's an initial phase of the painting. To be more precise, sketch really refers to the first phase of the work, actually a kind of composition. And so this also came before the actual work on the surface. That was the first, the previous video about the surface and also about drawing. So we're still exploring the very, very initial part of the painting. We could say that preparations, priming, imprimatura, grounds, these are all monochromatic bases that are applied to the surface and may include some idea of a sketch or an underpainting or an underdrawing or what is also called toning. This could be a part of this preparation. It just depends on the artist's technique. Now, priming generally refers to the preparation, the very, very first preparation of the surface. And we usually have some kind of glue that is together with an element of color or white or something. This can be used for all the different surfaces to paint on. And it's very important because it can determine the resistance of the painting and also give a certain brilliance to the painting as it is developed. It's important that it absorbs the oil a little bit. It's also water resistance, so you have a kind of a very particular kind of surface. Now, if you want to begin with a raw canvas or a raw piece of linen, you should always stretch this first, and I'll leave a link. You can watch a video that I did many years ago about stretching and priming a canvas. The frame should be considered. You don't want to have the surface of the linen or the canvas hitting the wood, because that will produce a line in the painting, a kind of a destructive line. And you should have some amount of oil in this preparation, in this priming stage, because the oil keeps the fabric elastic. Even though, most acrylic surfaces now, acrylic grounds, they do have a good amount of elasticity, but we don't really know how long they will last. The ground, you should have a good adherence between the fabric and the ground, because if that isn't intact, if it's not a good adherence, then your painting's going to come flaking off. It will destroy itself. So it's very, very important that it has a good amount of adherence to that fabric. Well, imprimatura is a Latin-based word. It comes from imprimere, which means to imprint or to press a substance onto a surface. So this is usually the first step. Following this, a similar step which incorporates the drawing could be considered. Let's look at a few examples from history that might help you understand this imprimatura. Here is a very, very famous painting by Leonardo, the Maggi, and I'll get very, very close to this so you can see. You can see that, you know, there's just a very, very, un abbozzo, like a very sketchy idea of the tones here. And it's monochromatic. He's not really going into any detail. But then slowly you can see that the detail is built into with different layers, and we'll see that also in this video. Here is another example. This is the entire painting. You can see various stages of this imprimatura. And here is a very famous painting by Rembrandt. There, if you can get very close to it, you can see here, for example, we have this dog that is just really sketched in. He really didn't go in for any kind of detail here on the dog. He just wanted an element here. And we don't know if this element comes after or before. It looks to me like probably this is the underpainting, and this gray, bluish area and the floor was done after, was painted around this. So this is like a remaining piece from that painting. So I'm in the studio now, and I want to explain first phase of this part of the painting. And we just looked very briefly the last time at the idea of drawing, but now we're going to actually look at closer each different phase. And I think that firstly, you know, taking into account what is called priming, okay, this painting, this surface, this canvas is white. It's already been primed. You see, this is a canvas that you can buy in the shop, and it already has a white priming. Artists have different tastes when it comes to how much they want the oil paint to be absorbed or not. Generally, this store-bought canvas is kind of plasticky. It doesn't really absorb much. It resists a lot, but it's okay. I have information about all of the different preparations that you can use in the notes. So I want to talk now about not just the priming, but what these other phases are called: underpainting, sketching, underdrawing, preparation. All of these different terms are a little bit vague. And just to give these phases, just to give these different phases a kind of harmonious, meaningful idea, let's just say that the underpainting and the preparation, this is what I've already done. Okay, this is just a yellowish color with oil and a very, very quick sketch. So there is also what is called the sketch or abbozzo, the underdrawing. There are a lot of different ways that you can get started into the painting. Okay, I will be using turpentine. I have two different kinds of brushes here. This one we'll use for the big strokes. It's a bristle brush. This is very, very hard. It's stiff, and it's good for this particular process. These are acrylic, synthetic, what would be like a sable brush, and I'm going to actually use this one. These are the types that we have here. They're not really very expensive. It's a set, and I'll be using this. Then I have the drawing, and the drawing of the painting. these I'll be referring to. And here on the palette, I have a pencil. This is a 14B pencil, very, 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 very soft. Or you can use a piece of vine charcoal. Then I've got here some turpentine in the little container. And the last item is the egg. This is an egg mixture. I'll maybe show another video with how to make the egg, but this you can buy, and it's okay. You add it to the white paint, and the paint becomes very, very stiff. You see, it's like more like a paste than what comes out of the tube. It's very, very stiff. And that's what we want for this phase of the painting. We want it to be very stiff. Okay, there's also a palette knife. I've got here a palette knife. I've got different kinds of palette knife. Just a couple more items here. I have this green umber, which is like earth green and sap green. I want to have a green type background. I have the greens here that I'm just going to mix, and this can be straight out of the tube. It's not that important. Everyone will have a different taste in terms of how much, how liquidy the paint should be. I'm not going to mix it much. I'm just going to take the big Brussel and start to mix this onto the canvas, just to show you. I want it to be quite transparent, so I'm not going to use the paint straight out of the tube, but actually with a little bit of turpentine. See, the vine gets mixed in, and I can use that for the drawing. Also with the pencil, if you do it with a pencil, you can have a similar effect. You see, it's even darker. But I'm drawing what I want as the under. You see, I can use this in this way. But what I'm not really interested in so much is the black. I want to talk about the whites. You see, I want the whites. I want you to get. I'm going to take some of this white, and I'll add a little bit of turpentine to it. See, I'm just dropping it into the center. Thank you. is taking off some of the impurities, some of the, you know, the bristles that, you know, I want it to be very, very smooth. I don't really want to see the paint strokes at this point. So I'm going to, you know, flatten everything, clean everything up. You see the impurities here. I want to get this out. And just to work with a very, very flat surface. So I'm going to use in this size to take, you know, really a lot of this excess paint off. I want it to be very smooth. This is just my taste. I'm working with a fine grain painting surface, so I want to have a very, very smooth surface. All right, I've had a couple of days. The painting is dry, so I'm going to continue by working and sketching. I'll actually use a pencil. I want to correct a little bit the inclination of the head to give this a little bit more of an incline of a head, so that the eyes are not. And I'm drawing directly on this, and so now I can start with the painting again. I'm going to correct also the background a little bit. Changed a little bit the background of the painting. I wanted it to be a little bit simpler. I've drawn the head a little bit more of an angle. These are things that I can do at this point of the painting. Affected a little bit. I don't know how the white is going to come out on the background. It's just chalk, so I'll have to probably redraw those lines, but I just want to have an idea. You see, I can push the paint into the white, and that's a lot of times how you get the really nice effect of the brush strokes. You can see your brush strokes better with this way, because the underpainting takes it actually takes the paint, and you can see the work that's done underneath. Okay, I think that's going to be sufficient. See, this is clearly a very dark area where his beard is and his hair. I'm not going to worry about that tone, because I'll be able to glaze that. I'm not going to really concern myself so much with the darks. I'm just concerned about getting the whites as white as possible. Thank you. happy with the white, the way that the white is built up here, and I'm just going to maybe put the light in a way so that you can see the reflection, and I'm just going to make it as smooth as possible so that there aren't any imperfections in the surface. Now there's some problems with the grain, some kind of grain or something in the paint that is causing this to... But I just want to get rid of those brush strokes a little bit so that I just have a white, because when you start glazing, all of this will show. Wrote about spirituality, and they perceived a supreme power, which they called the essence, his essence. It's a thought, an aim, to create creatures in order to delight. And this was generated, it came from the essence, and they called this the upper light. From the creatures' perspective, the light is the creator, and the essence could be called love. The contact between the creator and the creature is maintained through this love. The light, or the love, desired to create a creature and delight it by filling it with pleasure. That's the mission of the creature. Kabbalists called this creature the vessel. And the light filling, or the clothing. The totality of light emanates from his essence and is called Bahinat Shoresh, which is the root phase, because it is the root of the entire reality. That light then creates a desire to take pleasure in the light. That is called the will to receive, and that is the purpose of the creature. The intensity of the desire to receive is important because the desire for the vessel is for the filling. And without that desire, there's no pleasure, there's absolutely no love. And the pleasure that the creature feels when it receives the light is called Or Chokma, which is the light of wisdom. The desire created by the light that fills it is called Behina Aleph, the first phase. It's called by that name because it is the first Behina, the first appearance or the manifestation of the future vessel. That desire is not yet an independent one, as it is created directly by the light or the love, which we will see next.